that Budweiser fire and rescue crew to rescue you after you drink their beer and crash is all part of the Mother Goose Parade in El Cajon, California. We're here to visit the Unarius Academy of Science right down the block there, where since 1974, earnest seekers of the truth have come to hear the ideas and teachings of 93-year-old Ruth Norman, better known to her followers as Prince Uriel. Yes, that's right, loyal boob tube addicts. Spaceships from all over the galaxy are coming back to Earth in 2001, each one bearing 1,000 inhabitants from 32 other planets to bring happiness and wisdom and make life happy forever after on planet Earth. But this is only a small part of the so-called science of Unarius. One method Unarians employ to better understand themselves and what brings them to a place like El Cajon is their own unique form of past life therapy through their own unique form of psychodrama. What may look to you or me like one of the greatest Halloween costume parties this side of the San Francisco Gay Parade is actually a scientific method of diagnosing problems and illnesses by uncovering some heinous or horrible crimes you may have committed in a past life. Were you a cannibal? Were you a Republican? Were you Genghis Khan? But don't take my word for it. The Unarians are not alone in their fascination with UFOs and life in outer space. Richard Nixon and Jackie Gleason supposedly went to a CIA base in Nevada to view crashed spaceships. Elvis Presley was interested in UFOs. And notice how similar this painting on the walls of Unarius headquarters is to a certain Crosby, Stills, and Nash album. We are now inside the Unarius Academy with Leanne Stevens, a Unarius student.
Welcome, Jello.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too.
I'm a representative of Uriel, who is the founder and director of Unarius, and I'm a teacher of past life therapy here, and we're going to take you on a very special tour of Unarius.
But I can hardly wait.
In order to tour Unarius, you have to have your spaceship. So we're going to give you a choice of one of these spaceship pins. If you hold this one.
Oh, boy.
One is a pin and one
is a Titan. Cosmic stewardess wings? Or are they all upside down? Okay.
You want that one? Okay.
Well, that's a tie-tack, isn't it? Well, this one, I like the way this one glitters more. So this one here by any particular place I'm supposed to put it. Space Brothers wanted. There.
Oh, right here. And this spaceship pin now is a reminder that the brothers will land in the year 2001 on Earth, and they're coming in peace and love and brotherhood to help mankind on Earth. So this, when you wear this, this will remind everyone that you see that you're all for it, and it's a positive, wonderful development.
And why 2001?
Because by then it's determined that we'll be ready. And what we're doing today is part of getting ready. So as a representative of Uriel, I today am wearing many sparkly gems and jewels, as
those
you can see.
Those are her jewels originally,
these
are they
her,
not?
This is her actual jewelry, and through these sparkles, as you're watching at home, she's projecting her love, her light, her healing consciousness to each and every one of you. A very special radiation of love from Uriel to all the people watching.
And
through the spaceship as well.
And why isn't Uriel here with us? She was the one I wanted to meet the most.
Well, she is here in consciousness, very much so. And some of the people in the room here probably can feel that radiation of power and intelligence. Uriel is 92 years old, and this year, unfortunately, she broke her foot and her knee, so she's been bedridden as that bone is trying to heal, and she would be here otherwise.
And she won't take visitors? I mean, there are rumors flying around that she has been dead for a year or two, and like Scientology, there's a cover-up going on. How do you respond to that?
Preposterous. Uriel is here alive and well, and she is the director, as I said, of the daily operations of Unarius, our video production, our book printing, our operation of classes and past life therapy. She's very active and very involved, and even if she were not here physically, it would all go on as it has been planned to do in the future, because the body does have its terminating point, but she hasn't left.
You say her body has not terminated, you're saying.
No, she's very much alive.
Is her mind still all there? Because many people, when they get older, and in America, there is, unfortunately, Alzheimer's sometimes.
Uriel's mind is more intelligent, active, alive, and radiating with intelligence than you and I could hope to be in this lifetime, but someday in the future we may be. But she is very much involved and active and alert, and she's sending her love to all of you right here and now. She doesn't need to work through one physical body. She works through many channels, as do all individuals who have a higher development of consciousness. They are able to project their intelligence in a very directed way. That's what we're here studying, learning how to do. That's what Unarius is about, learning how to use the mind intelligently, creatively. You as a musician, we have musicians here, we learn to use that intelligence.
Yes, I am
creatively.
Hoping to take home a music album of what you may have created here.
We'll see what we
see what it does to my mind. Is there any connection between Unarius and Crosby, Stills, and Nash? Because I notice one of their album covers seems to be either a taken from the mural on the outside of that wall, or vice versa.
Oh, I know the one you mean. It's Gilbert Williams painted the beautiful starships coming down, and I think it looks like Machu Picchu. Gilbert Williams, who painted that picture, was very inspired when he did so, and we are painting starships here because of the same reason as the pin, to let people know that they do exist and there are people
living on other planets. How do you know what the starships look like? Has Uriel ever actually been on one?
Of course, in many lifetimes. Not only has she been on one, but she has been the commander of many space fleets.
Then what has prompted her to even bother with El Cajon, California, when she could be out in space cruising around somewhere?
Remember that when your mind develops to such a point that you're not limited to one physical body, you're working in all dimensions simultaneously, as all human beings do.
Oh, and so that's
the science that Unarius teaches, the science of the mind. So she isn't constricted.
So the brain sort of has many astral tentacles,
yes,
in other words.
Yes.
And do you believe all of her teachings absolutely verbatim?
Absolutely.
Is there any disagreement within Unarius on different points made by Uriel, or is it all accepted as the word?
Well, let's start from one point. The teaching of Unarius has been authored by millions of individuals of an advanced mental development. They've channeled their information into over 100 books, and so it's coming from quite a diversity.
But they didn't channel it directly onto the printed page at the printing press. They must have channeled it through somebody. Is that what you mean by human vessels?
Yes, and there are several individuals who serve as channels. I'm one. I've channeled several books. There are other students like myself who've learned to be open to that intelligence. Uriel herself is overshadowing, because her mind, it's like her mind encompasses other minds, and we are speaking interdimensionally. So everyone learns at their own rate. Everyone learns the teaching of Unarius at their own pace, and they become aware of certain elements of it individually. So it's not like it's one particular facet. This is a multifaceted teaching.
What happens when her physical being does leave this planet? Who's going to take over? What will happen to the Unarius Academy here?
We will carry on with everything that's been set in motion so far. There are a number of us who are developing our ability to speak to people like you, to continue printing and writing books, to continue producing our television programs. Our purpose
is to let people know. Intending to succeed her? Already been chosen?
Not to my knowledge. It's a group consciousness. It always has been, and it always will be. There are many, as I said, millions of brothers of light who are behind this mission to planet Earth.
Have you been on any of the spaceships?
In many lifetimes. In many lifetimes,
but
yes.
But not on this one?
Not in this present lifetime. I personally haven't. No, not in a physical way. But that doesn't matter, because I know they're real, I know they exist, I know that people do live on other worlds. It's only logical that we are not the only ones in the universe. But let me show you some
What do they think of some of the crazy things we do on this planet, like mass starvation while other people hoard, like Ross Perot, hoard billions of dollars, or the Gulf War? Why don't they intercede and stop this sort of thing now?
An intelligent being who's progressed in their evolution would never interfere in an individual's prerogative to learn through trial and error. And
all the people blown to bits in Iraq didn't have a chance to learn that. Other people killed them. Isn't there a way to intercede and maybe prevent that, like what's going on in Bosnia-Herzegovina right now?
These individuals are continuing on and are learning, because we don't believe in one single lifetime. These individuals are on a learning pathway. Those who kill and those who are killed have a karmic debt that will be resolved in the future. It's their responsibility. But no intelligent being would ever interfere in that evolutionary prerogative. Doesn't mean that they won't come and attempt to teach and enlighten us, as Buddha, Zoroaster, many Jesus, many countless Muhammad.
That brings me to Dr. Ernest Norman, who claimed to have been Jesus of Nazareth in a past life. Considering how many fundamentalist Christian cults are out there waiting for the imminent return of Jesus of Nazareth, Pat Robertson, Jerry Falwell, James Watt, and others, why didn't they spot him when he was around? Why did they miss each other?
Yes, and when Jesus was incarnated, why did no one understand what he taught? Same thing.
A lot of those people still don't understand what he taught, as far as I'm concerned.
True. It's very true. And the books here, the teachings here, he returned to complete his teaching, which was cut short by the crucifixion. And it is a very scientific understanding of life and consciousness, which was not completed and brought through to this planet. So now it has been, and it's been updated in the language of the 21st century, in our more scientific language. That's why it
Which
was
is what some Christians refer to as the imminent second coming, claiming that we're the last generation. And in the case of James Watt, our former Interior Secretary, used that as an excuse to justify oil drilling all up and down the California coast, strip mining national parks, etc., saying, well, because Jesus is coming back, we can ruin the earth now, because then we're going to have the second coming of the Lord.
That's a new one.
You never knew he did that?
He did
that within about the first year of Reagan taking office and him being Secretary of the Interior. In other words, people were using this revisitation by prophets for what I would interpret as being very sinister and greedy motives. How, as Unarians, can you prevent people from using your beliefs that way if they were to gain power before the Space Brothers came back?
Well, you can't halt people from their misconceptions and their low level of intelligence. You can only try to teach them a better way. And you said it yourself.
To me, in a way, that's when something where people are innocent, people are getting hurt or killed, or what's going on with the planet, that almost seems like a cop out to say that, oh, we can only teach them a better way, but we're not going to intercede to stop the slaughter in the former Yugoslavia, for example. Couldn't more be done?
Well, it's that intercession that's gotten people in trouble, that overstepping the bounds and infringing on someone else's life. There's a more intelligent way, and there's a very carefully devised plan that's been in effect for over a million years that Jesus was a part of, we are a part of, you are a part of, that is helping to enlighten the people of this planet. And it does show its effect. Look at Russia. Look at the changes in the world. There is a positive counter-movement at the same time. Those are the things that it's most healthy to focus our consciousness on and to be part of that more positive movement.
What about the space alien that's appeared three times on the cover of the Weekly World News talking to George Bush, Bill Clinton, and Ross Perot? Was he one of yours, or is he an imposter?
I didn't see it, first of all.
I would have brought it otherwise.
I can't really comment on it because I didn't see it, but I do know they are notorious for designing their own covers with a few you know, cut and paste jobs.
Of course, I'm just curious whether you believed it was a cut and paste job. This this alleged alien also claimed that some very conservative senators, Orrin Hatch, who's devout Mormon and to the right of Jesse Helms on some issues, and Senator Sam Nunn, were called fellow space aliens by this Weekly World News concoction, or perhaps real creature, who knows. And it didn't have the wide bug eyes like some of them did either. It was more like somebody with a big stocking suit on that walked off a Devo album, if you know what I'm talking about in
Very
that regard. Anyway, why don't we move on to the structure behind us? Speaking of Jesse Helms, people who are frightened of sex subliminals in advertising might see this as a very sinister sort of a vessel.
Actually, this is a design of Nikola Tesla. This is a power tower that will be used in the future to actually extract energy from the universe, electromagnetic energy, convert it into usable energy in this dimension, and supply free energy for all people on this planet, which will resolve many of the problems that you brought up earlier. Now, as you know,
how big will the power tower be? What scale model is this?
This will be over, and someone will have to correct me if I'm wrong, over 500 feet tall? 2,000 feet tall. 500 feet into the ground. 500 feet wide at the base. Thank you very much. And this will be a magnificent structure that the Space Brothers, after they land, will help us to build. And at that time, we will be able to break through and cut through all of the opposition to this idea that you know exists at the present time.
How so? Do you intend to use brutal means to break through the opposition?
No, of course not. It will be purely a matter of people's intelligence being awakened and the full mind being used.
That would come in handy.
Very much so. Shall we go on?
Let's talk about Tesla a little longer, because he's completely erased from science books that I was exposed to in school. I had never heard of him until a rock band named after him came out with an album. So who exactly was Nikola Tesla, and what do you see his significance as?
Nikola Tesla is one of those very advanced minds we were talking about. He incarnated at this time to bring us into the electronic age, and he is the one...
When was he alive, though?
That would have been right around 1920s, early part of this century.
What part of Europe was he from?
Yugoslavia. And he came to America. He worked with Edison for a while. They had a falling out. Edison didn't like his ideas, and Tesla
stole them like he did the black scientist who invented the light bulb while under contract to him in his lab. But that's another story.
That's the story of planet Earth. But Tesla brought through alternating current, which has made this television possible. And his development brought us into this new age, this 20th century into the 21st century. So Tesla's purpose, as one of the leaders of the Unarius mission, by the way,
he proclaim himself that at the time, or have you crowned him that?
His very intelligence coming through the various books in the present. We have a series of books called Tesla Speaks.
Yeah, I noticed that. Yeah.
He has described himself as who he is. His intelligence gives you the knowledge of who he is.
Could you describe a little bit how his ideas were suppressed in his lifetime, and by whom, and for what reason?
Well, I'm not a Tesla biographer, first of all, but obviously there are those individuals in the industrial military complex who want to suppress a certain type of progress because they have money invested in certain areas.
Such as General Motors buying up patents on electric cars and shelving them.
Exactly. So those are the things that we, people of Earth, will need to overcome. And just as you are now aware of it, I am now aware of it, more of us are aware of this opposition to progress, and we will, and it's our responsibility to take steps to stop that and demand a better way of life on this planet.
In addition to Tesla, are you aware of the work of Wilhelm Reich?
I have heard of his work.
Around the same time, and his device, the Orgone Accumulator.
Yes. A similar situation where here's an individual who has a spiritual development, who is trying to progress life on this planet. And it's a very old story. Jesus was crucified. Others have been murdered, their work suppressed, their work distorted. Same situation. What he was trying to achieve in the cure of cancer, or the knowledge of the electromagnetic nature of the human anatomy, the human consciousness, was suppressed by those forces.
He seems to be almost completely omitted from your literature as well.
Well, that's just a matter of time before everything is covered, but we have covered quite a spectrum of information.
Let's look at the map over here. If you look at the star map of the 33 planets of the Interplanetary Confederation, these planets are in the Milky Way galaxy. Planet Earth is represented here along with all of the other 32 planets in the Interplanetary Confederation.
What's that?
This is the central sun, the central spiritual sun, the interdimensional force field that powers the entire galaxy. And of course, there is a configuration of energy that you can keep tracing back through that powers the
infinite.
Are
there more planets and other systems that you know about too?
Absolutely, there
like
are an infinite number.
Like some up in the surfboard up on the wall there?
There are an infinite number of planets in
And do
the
they
universe.
All get along with the space brothers? Or, as I say, are we risking some horrible conflict by stealing their power for the cosmic power tower?
Well, planet Earth is the lowest frequency planet, and we are the laggard ones. We are the ones who most need this teaching of a better, more peaceful way of life. So all of these other planets are more developed than ours. They're leading the way for us, and they're sending their representatives here in 2001.
My question was about the other ones that might be even more laggard that we don't even see on the chart.
Well, why should we worry about what we can't see on the chart? This is our galaxy. These are the more positive leaders of our galaxy, and this is where we are going. This is our direction that we have
okay,
set up.
To your left, we have a mock-up here of what appears to be flying saucers.
It is, very
it
much.
It sort of looks like a pop music album release display you'd find at Tower Records or something, but what does it mean to you?
This was built to represent the way the 33 starships will land and connect with one another in a towering structure that will be 33 stories tall, and this will be the University of Unarius that the brothers will build when they land in 2001. So this was a replica.
Where does the 33rd one come from? There were 32 planets.
The
Where's 33rd, the last one?
That's a good question. The 33rd ship is at the very top. It's the smallest ship. And this ship is being built for our purposes, for travel around planet Earth. This ship is Planet Earth's spaceship that is being built on the planet Vixal and may already have been built because we are only 9 years away from the space boot landing.
Yeah, it seems to me if the 2001 movie is to be believed, we have an awful lot of advances to go in the next 9 years if we're going to make it to Jupiter or whatever.
A lot can happen in a short space of time, as we've seen in the last year. Quite a bit has changed on this planet that we never expected to happen so quickly, and that's how quickly we can move forward once we're willing.
With me now is Dr. Charles Spagel, known to his students as Antares. Tell us a little about this painting here. That's supposed to be you, isn't it?
That was me.
Was you.
This is a depiction of an individual who's known as Tyrantus. He had many names throughout his evolutionary development and descent.
Wasn't that long ago you were Tyrantus in the flesh, weren't you? Or we have leader of the entire 100 planets of the Orion constellation, known to some as Satan, Orion War Conference table here. Almost seems to be going out of your way to look like a Hollywood version of what the devil might actually look like. Were you once Satan?
I was known as Satan, Lucifer, Beelzebub, and Napoleon, even Julius Caesar. These were all people who lorded over the masses and used their so-called powers to advance themselves in society and eventually attempt to rule the then-present world.
And so you're saying there's not just one Satan, like the Bible seems to imply, but there are many.
No, there is one Satan. There was one individual who generated so many different personalities, but the Bible is a misrepresentation of the reality that Satan is a depiction of the lower self, the dark self, that angry self that exists within all people. We were...
So you don't feel that Satan liked himself very much then?
Well, he liked
did
himself
he enjoy his
up
work?
Until the time that this painting shows how he was reawakened
by his spirit. Uriel, I assume.
By Uriel, the cosmic visionary, the healing archangel, and it has been her purpose throughout hundreds of thousands of years to come back to rescue not only Tarantus, as he was known at this time, but all of those individuals who he took down the left-hand path. In other words, he blotted out the purpose of progressive evolution.
But how do we know that Tarantus or even yourself are not simply pretending to have changed in order to fool people in this life and continue your devilish ways?
By example, as has been stated by Jesus of Nazareth, the proof of your present consciousness is in the works and what you do. I should make a point and make this statement. That book that you are looking at, Pictorial Tour of Unarius, contains photographs of what we call past life therapy. These were psychodramas that we actually filmed of our past.
Right.
You see, I am not living the life of Tarantus and so on of these past. I'm working them out by identifying myself as well as all the students who
were
involved.
Some of the students, and I think even Uriel, when going through their past lives, there seems to be a remarkable number of famous people and celebrities that pop up rather than ordinary folks, and in some cases, characters out of literature or paintings rather than flesh and blood human beings. How do you explain that?
Many of these people were not the individuals who were portraying them. However, the negatively biased people are not famous. We have to use the word infamous. These people have heavy karma. Their lives are overshadowed by dark clouds and terrible guilts and so on.
But why the preoccupation with celebrities? Almost everybody I've ever known who's felt that they've had past life experiences, they'll cite Michelangelo, cite movie stars. One woman I knew never forgave me when I pointed out that Greta Garbo was still alive when she insisted she was a reincarnation of Greta Garbo.
Well, you're speaking of two opposite aspects of life, the positive forces, Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci, the great teachers and artists. Those people are not ones who have deterred man's consciousness. You see, those are the leaders and they're the teachers. They're the inspirational forces of the Unarius Brotherhood. The negative people who formed a what they call Black Brotherhood are people whom I led. And we are, not all of us, but there's a nucleus of those who have asked for help, and in the astral planes before we reincarnated, we asked to be given an opportunity to readdress our wrongs by returning
out
our
past. Do you run into anybody who has simply gone through past lives as maybe a termite, then a farmer, than a plant or whatever, but never a celebrity? I mean, it seems that there's only so many Michelangelos to go around that all the millions of people on Earth couldn't all have been the same person in their past life.
Right, I understand what you're saying. However, those are the positive forces who are the examples of progressiveness and who have helped mankind through the works of art, you know, his paintings and the classics of his architecture, etc. They are the light at the end of the tunnel. You see, they're the individuals who, as an example, are people who we look forward to lead a integrated life. Unarius teaches a basic therapy called past life therapy to help all mankind, all individuals, have a hidden past. There's skeletons in everybody's closet.
I'm still astounded at how many people's skeletons are celebrities.
Well,
it gets in the way of my buying the past life theory sometime. At least the Buddhists let the animal kingdom in on things.
But
do the Hindus.
If you're speaking about those individuals, artists, philosophers, scientists, who provided
knowledge. Not just the scientists, but we're also talking lots of people. I was Genghis Khan in a past life.
Well, he's not a positive oriented person. Genghis Khan lived the life of Hitler.
Well, this much we know, but why couldn't they have picked a warrior or whatever? It seems like this may not be a legitimate trance if all they can come up with is celebrities.
Well, let's make a point. People who have lived before and are reincarnated now don't know who they were until they make that effort and want to uncover their past so that they can lead a life of spirit. That means to be a help to mankind. You know,
what if the person finds out that all they were in their past lives are really horrible people, horse thieves, murderers, Genghis Khan, and up until they found this out, they were happy, and then they have an emotional collapse.
It can't be that way, you see. You are what you have been before. You form the hard disk of all those lifetimes. That is information you use to live in the present. It's a continuity. You can't be any different. The mind is an energy format, and that is collated. It's just programming it on the computer.
So you're almost talking about encoding the way Scientologists do, then. Do you agree with
them on
that?
Nothing to do with Scientology. Unarius is a pioneering organization that is the, what shall we call it, the teaching of a progressive evolution. And the teachers are all those individuals who are the examples of their teaching. Uriel, Leonardo da Vinci, Jesus of Nazareth, the great artists and philosophers of old, Descartes.
How about Elvis Presley?
Elvis Presley is a young soul to a great extent, although he
There is a growing movement that of people who believe he was a genuine prophet.
No, he's not really anyone of any consequence in terms of his knowledge of the physics of energy. See, Unarius is a bona fide teaching of a science of life, and that is a fourth dimensional physics. It explains the mind and consciousness. It explains where you are, where you've been, and how to keep a balance.
Do you network
with other... Not by getting
other...
down on the knees and bowing to someone else.
I like that. Do you network at all with other so-called UFO groups or believers in outer space beings?
No, we don't network. We are the books that have been written. Over 125 titles and about 50 manuscripts yet to be published are direct contacts with the Space Brothers. Who are the Space Brothers? They're people like you and I who have integrated their understanding of evolution.
What
and
do they look
the
like?
People like you and I. You could be a Space Brother, a human being, a Homo sapiens.
Would I look like a Space Brother if I was from one of the other 32 planets? Do they all look like humanoids?
They're human beings, just like you and I.
Do some of them have eyes growing out the tops of their heads, or is it all of a humanoid nature?
No. There are humanoids, but those humanoids were made by people like you and I who once lived in these technological societies which was bereft of any spiritual understanding. That is the continuity of life. What you do now, you'll live and relive the consequences.
So who are the beings that you see sometimes illustrated in mainstream and not so mainstream publications almost every single time? Bald head, sloping forehead, large, almost reptilian or insect eyes. These are the kind that some people claim are kept under lock and key by the CIA or the Defense Department in the Nevada desert, along with their crashed spacecraft near a town called Rachel. Do you have no connection with that or believe any connection with that?
You see,
Nixon and Jackie Gleason did. Did you have any contact with Nixon and Jackie Gleason?
No.
I'm going too fast, I know.
No, it isn't that. It's this. We are a scientific educational organization. We get behind what you call the cinema with the phenomena of life and explain it. You see, this is, you're getting down to the substratum of what makes things happen. Don't forget there are hundreds of millions of planets, hundreds of millions of planets in this galaxy with people on them. This is just being discovered. And
By who?
by many people who are involved in the UFO movement and who have evidence. Now, many of
these people... So there is a UFO movement beyond Unarius that maybe you do have contact with.
It's not a matter of being
it.
Beyond it. It's that, is
I,
that,
I didn't mean beyond it, but yeah. In the sense of beyond it this way. I meant like in other towns and other places and working under other names. There are others then.
Well, they're not integrated. They're all working independently. There's all kinds of organization, MUFON, so on, Mutual UFO Network. But they are basically physically oriented in the phenomena of it. We explain it because the reality of life is that the infinite creative intelligence, which is the cosmic mind, whatever you call it, people, the religionists have used the word God, has generated an infinite number of people, if you might call it that, who become who are endowed with the quality, and that quality is intelligence. And their purpose is to evolve, to learn of that inner nature, that self, the real brain, not the physical brain, but the real brain, which is hooked up, you see, to the interdimensional nature of life.
Okay, and you described your approach as being different from others because it is scientific, and yet yeah. Some of what I see here, the statues, the paintings, Uriel often being depicted as a divine being, does make it appear to be more of a religion, complete with what it appears to be, the main evidence is taking the words of Uriel or Ruth Norman at face value and believing it verbatim, without what normally would be considered scientific evidence to back it up. So are you a science or are you a religion?
You see, that's all an interpretation from your own association to religious organization, etc., from your past lifetime. You can only see and become conscious of and perceive an understanding of what we call life based on what you have in your hard disk. In other words, what you have experienced. Now, if you've been overly accepted religiously doctrinaire concepts of life, and you have a negative attitude towards it, you'll react to it. So whatever people react to is based on their previous life experiences, you see. Now, it's not easy for people to give up what they consider to be the truth that they carry in their back pocket to be a upright person and to really be a forward futuristic individual, you have to know about the future.
So when did it dawn on you that this was part of your future and your past? Did it dawn on you when you were a kid or when you were 20? Or
yeah, right. It happened over many number of years, but ever since I was a kid, I was sort of a bookworm. I was always trying to find out something, but it really happened when I heard someone talking about a book called The Voice of Venus. It attracted me to that individual. I asked him for the name of the book and the author and where I could buy it. And when I read that book, That Voice of Venus, the first publication of the Unarius Foundation, that's what got me, because it answered the questions. And that is, what is life? What's it all about? Why do I feel unhappy, distressed? Why am I agitated, and I don't seem, you know, have any objectives in life.
So in a sense, you were sort of born again then.
Everybody is. We're all born again. You can't die, don't you see? And that's what Unarius answers. It answers the very question that everyone is attempting to resolve, and that is, what is life? How am I involved in life? Why can't I get along?
I do admire the sense of fashion of Unarius. It certainly is a lot more creative than most places I've seen. What inspired this fashion to begin with? Especially Uriel's purple beehive wigs.
Well, there's two different things we do. The costumes that we put on are for psychodrama purposes. The things that Uriel has worn is her way of recreating a more beautiful state, and her costumes are obviously much more beautiful than some of these concoctions. But she's remembering other lives when she dressed more beautifully. We're working out our past lives.
And you were saying in the costume room that I was performing or experiencing a psychodrama just on the basis of which ones I was picking out, wishing I could take home.
What you're drawn to, for instance, what you're wearing now is something that's familiar to you from your previous lives. In a lot of ways, a lot of times, that's how we find out.
Does this mean I was Satan in a past life, too?
I'm referring to your hat.
Ah, okay. One of the two of you on one of the video of one of the gatherings talked about how important it was that once you joined Unarius, you no longer felt the need to have long hair.
That was me.
Why was it so bad to have long hair, and why was it such a cleansing experience to get a preppy do?
There's nothing wrong with having long hair. Although for me, it was a negative attunement to a past lifetime. In particular, where I was, by having the long hair, I was always in tune with that same negative experience. I had a bad experience. What happened to me was I was executed in a certain style in China. It was a symbol of pride for the man to have long hair. And before I was executed, my hair was severed, and then my head was chopped off. And so I was in, by regrowing that hair, it was a symbol of pride to me to say, yes, this was sort of like a manly expression, but at the same time, it was reattuning me constantly to have my head chopped off. And so I always had headaches with it. I thought it was because my hair was heavy and there was a lot of it. But really, that's why it was a negative attunement.
Maybe it was sunny California and the ozone layer disappearing that was just, since you have dark hair, it was just all that heat reflecting off.
And I do have a picture on my, I still have my old license, which might serve a purpose to stream.
Kind of look a little bit like Axel with a mustache there, don't you? That could get you in a lot of trouble if a cop pulled you over and couldn't tell it was you at all.
I got a lot of trouble.
My collar fell down. What does that all mean? Yeah, because that was one thing I found, like, in some of the confessionals on the video, it struck me as being a little bit sinister when people were completely disowning everything that seemed to be both negative and positive about how they were living before joining the Unarius Academy, which sort of reminded me of the very dark side of fundamentalist Christianity. In other words, that is at times acting as though you had allowed yourselves to possibly be brainwashed.
Can I comment on that?
Yes.
The only thing I gave up was that was holding me back. Drugs, an obsession with heavy metal that was only clouding my mind. And number two,
heavy metal always clears mine, but go on.
Well, I was into Black Sabbath, some of the really, really heavy groups, and I used to go to sleep with it. So I was just part of my consciousness all the time. But what you said earlier about celebrities, I don't think anybody in this group here has really lived a famous life. And if we have, we don't really talk about it. All my lives have been fairly common. But it's been a real unraveling to find out which ones they were, because every life holds a key. And every key has opened up a door and has made me a better person to find out who I've been, even though it may have only been a florist, a musician, a taxidermist, a chef in Morocco.
Yeah, I guess what I'm getting at is there's certain things that I myself have had to fight to even, in my own music, even fight for its right to exist. In my case, being brought into court by the LAPD and put on trial for one of my albums because they felt it was obscene and I didn't. And I fought it on First Amendment grounds. But a lot of the people pushing for labeling on rock records and censoring certain artists, including me, are claiming that the music itself, which I try to make my music a very positive, enlightening thing, even if I use very graphic and sometimes negative images to do it, But this same suppression of, like, Black Sabbath automatically being negative. I mean, Black Sabbath made me feel great when I was a kid, when otherwise I was depressed or something like that.
I loved it.
If I hadn't seen the Ramones at a certain time, decided, hey, I want to be in punk rock too, I might have killed myself. Who knows?
Classical music. How did that make you feel?
I think it affected me because the rest of my family listens to it to this day, so I heard a lot of it growing up and didn't like much of it except for Carl Orff and maybe a few others, but I've noticed I put little classical things in my punk rock songs, whether I'm thinking about it or not, that might not be there otherwise. Okay, you know, with this debate going on, is Ruth Norman even still alive or not? Another one that I asked Dr. Spiegel earlier was, how do we know that he still isn't Tyrantus, disguising himself as somebody else in order to hoodwink all of you?
You're not the only one that's asked that question. A lot of us have, because of our memory of who Antares was. We've had tremendous reactions to him. We've mistrusted him. We've hated and resented who he represented to us. But in his channeling of the books and the help, Akashic readings, past life readings, he has given to us individually. And in his caring for Uriel, he has proven a love and a loyalty that goes far beyond anything any of us have ever experienced. And he is no more Tyrannus than you are, Ron Hubbard.
How do you know he won't turn bad again?
We know that because of the direction he's gone now, that he's given irrevocable proof of the direction he's heading. That's into the light. The changes he has made are so monumental.
What is the irrevocable proof?
The proof is in his consciousness, in the way he has changed toward us, his ability to help us now. And
how was he hindering you before?
He was hindering us before he was able to work out his past. And we were not working out our past. Of course, we are only reliving. We are regenerating all the sum and total of all those lives that you're talking about now.
So have any of you in this lifetime ever been on any of the spaceships?
I haven't, but I've seen one up real close.
Where?
In Lucerne Valley, in the high desert of California, near Victorville.
What did it look like?
It looked brilliant. We were very close to it. It was at night, and we just happened to turn our eyes toward the mountains, and there was this most brilliant light. Lights. They were all the different colors of the rainbow, and they were just like dancing and swirling very fast, intermingling all together, and it just like hovered there very close to the ground.
Some of the psychodramas seem to be inspired by science fiction. Are science fiction books and movies inspired by past life occurrences?
Yes.
And if you've got examples, which it sounds like you do, please explain.
The novel called 1984 by George Orwell is one brilliant example of a person who was inspired to recreate a past life situation. This particular past life was the continent of Mu, or Lemuria. And George Orwell wrote very well about the past suppression of the individual human spirit and the overriding strict control over human development. Now, George Orwell wrote that about communism. He was being inspired by a previous lifetime. H.G. Wells, who wrote many, many science fiction novels, also was inspired by previous civilizations.
Another Orwell historian I know well, who's even had his name legally changed to Winston Smith, insists that Orwell actually based that book on the British government at the time, and the original title was 1948, and the publisher went and changed it on him.
But the basic intent of George Orwell, the spark of inspiration in his mind, was definitely a continuity of previous lifetimes and past lives. H.G. Wells himself lived in the Orion civilization 800,000 years ago.
Science fiction in itself is not anything that is made up in one's mind. It's actually images of those very things that have happened in the past. There really is no such thing as, at least in this particular dimension, as that kind of just, oh, it just popped into my mind. Well, it's been actually images from previous experiences that people have gone through or have in some way experienced. For example, you made reference to the book by H.G. Wells, War of the Worlds. That's why when, for example, he gave that radio broadcast, it affected so many people, was because it brought back that psychic memory in each one of them of exactly what took place back at the end of the Orion civilization when this civilization was at war with each other. And it brought back such a tremendous fear that it became a real mass hysteria at that time of the broadcast.
I want to finish with flying saucers real quick here. I noticed a lot of the people, when they report seeing them, again, flash of light, gleaming flash of light, and then all of a sudden, poof, it's gone. They're very elusive, sneaky, almost. I'm not necessarily ready to interpret that as a sign of friendly behavior. Maybe it's just space teenagers joyriding and picking on the little earthlings to amuse themselves, which I come from a state where there was an epidemic of cattle mutilations, where they would find cattle with blood sucked out and two little prongs or neatly carved cuts of meat taken out. The governor had to go on TV to say, no, no, we're not being invaded by aliens. There aren't Satanists everywhere chopping up your cattle. But that was what it brought to me that, wait a minute, these I wonder if there's juvenile pranksters running around instead of TPing trees, they're going around mutilating cattle on Earth.
Well, for instance, there's so many different types of people on this Earth. There's just as many different types of people out there on other planets. So the starship I saw definitely was not, had anything to do with that. It was...
But there are devious ones out there, or questionable ones,
well,
as well as the ones you're fond of.
I don't know anything about the devious ones.
Because how do you know the good space brothers will win out? I saw an Outer Limits episode years ago where a giant creature from outer space played by Richard Keel, who was Jaws and James Bond later on, and they put him on platform shoes, gave him this huge head, came to Earth as a benevolent visitor from space and magically taught Earthlings how to grow more food, get rid of their desert climates. Everybody was happy, prosperous, and they were getting all these free trips on spaceships to the aliens' planet. Everybody was so happy until somebody popped the question, wait a minute, no one has ever come back to say what it was like. They're growing us Earthlings for their food supply. What proof do you have that the Space Brothers don't intend to mine our bone marrow or simply take over the planet and use us for Space Brother burgers or something? Somebody better answer that. This has kept me awake at night.
I'll speak up here. We have, the proof is in our own healing and our own usage of the principles which are in the books, which are coming from directly the Space Brothers.
And what if they're healing you so you'll make a better meal later on, just like they feed this special grain to cattle so it'll say they could get a higher price from Safeway?
Well, that in itself is a memory from Orion. There was a planet of people that were taken for food. So that is a memory that is being replayed within the psychic anatomy of an individual. But these brothers, once you start the study and once you start to make that attunement with them, you feel their love and light. I mean, you feel that intelligence. And
But many loving, intelligent people got overrun by not-so-loving, intelligent people. Witness Europeans' attacks on Native American peoples and things like that. How do we know that if the Space Brothers are ushered in here, somebody else might not follow them and destroy the whole thing for the brothers and for us? Is there any proof of that either way that you know of? Or is this all being done on faith and somebody, some other force may actually be conning the Space Brothers to con you?
I'll address that question.
A lot of our fears, like you've described, are coming from our own past life memories of having done those very things. And all of the students sitting here are individuals who recognize themselves having done those very things to other peoples, other civilizations, other planets, having been part of governments that did take over in that way. So we're very familiar with where that fear comes from and that particular nature
of
our
negative
past. But
how are you so positive it won't happen again?
Very positive, because of the nature of the individuals that we've been in contact with through these books, the nature of their intelligence, the nature of their understanding of life, and they have demonstrated it and proven it to us time and time and time again. And we're thoroughly convinced, because each day we've questioned and weighed, is this positive, is this negative, and it proves itself out to be positively and helpfully oriented toward the Earth people.
In this room probably has an opinion about Charles Manson.
Yes.
And I know several people, because of the length of Manson's writings, his songs, and whatnot, who consider him to be a gifted and possibly divine philosopher who screwed up a few times in his life. How much have you ever studied any past life history or the so-called teachings of Charles Manson?
Who would want to?
Who would want to put their consciousness in that kind of material? Our consciousness is in positive works and teachings that are channeled from positive advanced intellects.
I can bring people here who claim that most of Manson's teachings, taken out of the context of the murders, were also very positive.
Well, that's just the thing. By their fruits, you should know them. Manson's fruits are murder. It doesn't matter what he wrote about. It's the fruits of his life, of ending other people's lives. That's going against the very infinite soul, the very part of their soulic purpose. That prematurely ends their cycle here. He had no right to do that. All murder is negative.
Okay.
And keep in mind, too, anybody who has a negative development, no matter how powerful it is, that negative development once at one time in evolution was positive. So they may very well be remembering Manson when he was a more positive person, but who did, you say, make a big mistake. He did, but many thousands of years ago, and he has now taken whatever positive development he once had, and he's inverted it, and now he's become a very powerful negative force, much like Tyrannus. But Tyrannus was able to turn it around and has changed, unlike Manson, who is continuing on that downward trail.
His teachings are nothing compared to Jesus Christ. In fact, I've even heard him say he was Jesus, you know, incarnated or something like that. Or his teachings are the continuity. That is total lower astral insanity.
That's an interesting concept, lower astral insanity.
Or obsessions.
What would you do if on her deathbed Uriel told you she made the whole thing up? And that none of this was actually true.
It just won't happen.
There's no way. We've proven it to ourselves too much that what she has taught all along has been valid, because we validated it for ourselves. We've seen the changes within ourselves. We all have experienced tremendous healings and feelings of freedom and relaxedness and growth within our own lives, that there's no way that if some comment like that were made that it would be received in any way of acceptance, because we know that it's true. There's just no questioning it.
And also, Uriel is an example of the principles of what she teaches. All of these principles are in the books, and any of the fruits, any of the benefits, anyone can gain at home, at study, through studying these principles.
You talk about studying principles and how there's just no question of it, and yet you deny a religion. You're a religion, and one of the main definitions of a religion is having a text that you're not supposed to question.
Oh, we
question it all the time.
Right.
Times a week.
We're asked questions.
Have you had any disagreements with Uriel then?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Can you give an example?
Oh, in everything. As a student, you go through every kind of disagreement within yourself until you see yourself reflected as being kind of stupid. And then you see the larger picture and you realize, oh, I didn't look at it that way. I didn't look at the whole picture. You're right. I can see the whole picture. It's like any teacher and student. The teacher's painting the larger picture and you've got a small mind.
Has anybody ever wound up changing the view or opinion of the teacher?
No.
Ruth Norman, Prince Uriel, has not been seen publicly in, 2 years now at least? I was hoping, I was just waiting, hoping to confer with her here, but she isn't here. And people are telling me, well, she's up the road, she's fine, but they're very reluctant to offer proof of that to the outside world. Is this a similar situation to the Church of Scientology disguising the death of L. Ron Hubbard for several years and claiming he was channeling his wishes through his attorney? How many of you have direct visual proof that Uriel is still alive?
I do.
You've all met her.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yes, of course.
We have all talked to her. So why can't we
see her then?
On the telephone, and she sends Uriel today on the telephone, sends her love, light, healing, consciousness, and power to everyone watching this. She's very much alive and well. She just has a broken foot. She's not very mobile at the moment.
But we were willing to come to her.
She recently had a freelance photographer taking photographs of her. I have some photographs of her, and if you'd asked me ahead of time, I would have brought the photograph with me. Maybe we can videotape it later. You can see a recent photograph of her.
We could call her on the phone.
Sure.
You want to call her now?
Good evening, Jello. Uriel here.
Hi.
How do you do?
Pretty good. How are you?
Well, about as good as I have been for the last year. I'm really kind of glued to this bed. It doesn't stop me from carrying on with my business, which is the center down there and all the students.
Are you able to mentally travel?
I'm not able to get out of bed, but I'm able to compute and mentally attune, and I'm doing a lot of editing. I've edited 6 books in the last 6 weeks.
Wow.
And so we're going forward with the work.
Are you able to leave your physical body to travel around?
Sure. Oh, sure. But,
so you're not really bedridden, per se.
Here. My work is for these people here. My work now is not for the people in the astral or the spiritual worlds. We have plenty of other people to work in those higher dimensions.
So you're concentrating on the academy in El Cajon, then?
Sure. That's why I came here. I prepared for many, many years for the help for these earth people, because the biggest part of them don't know that life is continuous. They still believe in death, that when man so-called dies, that he's really dead. I mean, there's so many important things that man needs to learn to live a happy, progressive life.
Well, I'm sure glad you're able to at least talk to us on the phone here. I was looking forward to actually meeting you, but I understand your situation. If there's one thing you would want to say to everybody watching this on television, what is the most important message you want the viewers to know?
The earth people is forget about this idea that when you die, you die. I still get letters every few days where people say, my husband or my son died, and oh, we're oh so sorry. There is no such thing as death. Man lives eternally when he so-called dies. He simply slips out of his body and moves on into the astral. That's the next abstract world. It's a higher dimension than this world, and there he lives and learns what he needs to know the next time he incarnates in some other world. Now, all according to what he has prepared to do, it makes the decision of whether he moves forward or backward. He could go either way.
You touched on an interesting point, namely people grieving over the loss of, say, their children.
The loss of somebody.
So,
they don't lose anybody.
Will they ever actually meet their children again in another life? Will they know it's their children?
They're created, you see. That's the way families are brought together, through this oscillation, this frequency, energy oscillation, because they have built that up through many lifetimes. And very often, this is why twins appear as twins, and this crazy thing they're going around with so much now, homosexuality and crisscross sexual relationships. These are incidences where men and women, you know, have become mixed up in their relationships.
So you don't agree with homosexuality.
And of evolution, it will explain every problem, every need that man has. But he does, first of all, have to understand the principle that man is an energy being, and that he does not die, he lives forever and ever and ever.
How many...
He is constantly building him a better psychic anatomy for the future.
Sorry to change the subject here before I go, but I have to ask, from what photos and videos I've seen of you, you appear to be one of the best-dressed human beings in the universe. How many wigs do you own? I've seen several different colors in the books.
I only have about 100. If I had my choice, I had a couple hundred. I just think it's fun to have a different wig any time you want to have it to match with your garment. And I design my own gowns, and I have a lady who makes them. I just design them, and she makes them. I have fun creating my costumes for the video, and people love to see it.
Oh, yeah. I was telling Leanne and the others when I went into the costume room, if you ever have a garage sale, be sure to give me a call.
It doesn't mean anything. It's just my pleasure. Everybody has to have some little thing that he latches onto, and that happens to be, I like, now, for instance, the young girl you have down there now, my protege, Leanne, she's all decked out in some of my jewelry. Doesn't she look lovely?
Oh, yeah.
And she's my polarity, I'm sure, in one lifetime, quite like four or five lifetimes in the past. I'm sure she's been my daughter. Right now, I could take her into my home and raise her as my daughter. But she's doing a much better job by living alone and taking her part as a teacher and director of my classes.
So
I'm 93, going on 94.
And somewhere I heard that you intended to stay around as Ruth Norman, as Uriel, for at least 20 years after the Space Brothers land, which would make you close to 120.
I hadn't planned anything exactly like that.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You hear a lot of tales, no doubt. But whatever, I know I will be directing and motivating that fleet, you see. The fleet, the 33 starships, will all be connected, and I will be operating them. I will bring them to Earth. I will go on out to planet Ares before they land and bring them here on this world. See, I have purchased property, about 100 acres up in the hills. It's virgin property.
And that's the one that's photographed in your book.
Where this fleet will land, and they will build one on top of the other. I think if you look around there in the center, you will find a dummy that we have built to illustrate how the ships will be.
I think it's prominently displayed in the main room. Yeah. If I'm thinking of the same one, yeah. I don't think it's in the cellar. I think it's where everybody gets to see it.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much for taking the time to talk. It's been a pleasure, and I look forward to the landing.
Well, we all do. I can't wait, but the only reason we're not landing now, we could come any day, but the biggest part of the Earth people are not ready. they would take pop shots at us, and we're not interested in that.
Do you think the Earth people will ever be ready for something like this, though?
That's why I'm here. That's exactly why I'm here, to try to help the Earth people to become ready. We're putting out books now, new books. We already have 125, but we have 25 more in store that, with other attractive titles that will help prepare the Earthman. And he is now, at this point, he is at the point of openness and readiness more than he's ever, ever been. I noticed some of the prominent video production, the continuous production that they show from 1 week to the next, are now showing pictures of this innuendo, although they haven't really gotten completely into it about life after life after life. But they are showing things that shows that they're preparing.
Yeah,
and that's what I'm interested in and trying very hard to do. And successfully so. We're spending all we possibly can on advertisements and magazines.
So where are you advertising? I've never seen one.
Beg your pardon?
Where are you advertising?
Oh,
I've never seen an advertisement.
Many catalogs.
Oh, I see. They're your own. You don't run ads in other publications then.
Oh, sure. We'll advertise any place that somebody suggests.
Well, I would suggest Time and Newsweek for starters.
We have had articles in Time and Newsweek. I think we still have one on Newsweek. Do we not, Andrew? Not right this minute, but we have had. Well, we put it wherever that someone may suggest or we feel inclined. It isn't that we limit it to one a week. We're advertising in 8 or 10 different magazines, and some of them are rather new. But thank you for calling.
Oh, yes. It's good to speak with you.
Okay.
And take care, get well, and hope...
Oh, it's just a couple of broken bones in my right foot. I'm really not sick, but I have to lie here to rest my... my foot so that my bones will grow together.
Right.
But I want to project the energy, the light, and the power. I want to have a light projection for you. So if you'll just remain quiet just a moment, we'll have a projection of power, light, that many of the brothers are going to join in here now. At least 33 light-filled, space-filled brothers. So here goes the projection.
Through the phone to me?
What?
Are you saying this is through to the phone to me?
Yes, I'm just saying this to you, to whoever might be listening. This power is being projected to you, and everyone who listens should hear this light, should sense and feel this great power of love, light, infinite energy that has passed through the consciousness of we the brothers. Thank you for calling, and may you walk in peace and love. Good night.
Peace and love to you too.
Thank you.
Good night.
And there you have it, the Unarius Academy of Science, and it's open to the public in El Cajon, California. Ruth Norman is not inside one of her all-time favorite costumes now, but that conversation on the phone convinces me she is very much still with us and seems to have a lot more sense of fun than many other movement leaders we can both think of, and a lot more entertaining even than Robert Tilton. And no matter what you may think of Unarians or Robert Tilton, sleep on this tonight. What if the Unarians are right?
tell us about the dead Kennedys? You said they helped to enlighten.
How did you talk about our audiences?
Too enlightening. I was into Slayer and Metallica and Exodus and all that Venom and that stuff.
Oh, so Venom's great, man. I've never given up on Venom.
I can't understand any of the words.
Any band that's, that absolutely cannot sing has a worse production on purpose of any metal band I've ever heard, and all their songs are about Satan and angel dust. I mean, how can you go wrong? I've driven so many people out of my house with Venom, that's great.
Did you know the Kennedys aren't dead? They're alive and well on the other side and still continuing their work. There's a dissertation from them in one of the Unarius books.
Well, maybe if I sent you some of my albums, you could figure out whether they're channeling their messages through my work or not. That would be the height of irony.
Could very well be. If they're positive messages, it could very well be.
Oh, I think they're very positive. People say they're too negative because I talk about negative things, but you've got to alert people to that first in order to get the problem solved. That's what a lot of rappers do, and that's why there's so much heavy legal hassle on them, is because they're portraying the side of society that caused the Rodney King riots and things that Tipper Gore and her friends didn't want white suburban teenagers to know existed.
Well, the Kennedy brothers are still involved in that element of life, as all the brothers are on the other side. The scientists are doing scientific work. The politicians are helping the political aspect. So it's very possible anyone who's involved in a positive way is going to be overshadowed by those particular individuals. So it may have been no accident.
Did you know who John F. Kennedy was in his previous life?
No.
Abraham Lincoln. Do you know who?
You know who else has claimed that? Muammar Gaddafi. A big admirer of Abraham Lincoln.
The assassination, you know, took place the very same way. It was a reliving.
Except that Lincoln was assassinated by the 1860s equivalent of a very popular rock star. John Wilkes Booth was a major celebrity and a sex idol of his time, wherever Lee Harvey Oswald may not have even pulled the trigger, right, and nobody knew him from Adam.
We're not talking specifically about the physical. We're talking about the negative forces are really the ones who put the thoughts into people's mind to assassinate people in the first place.
Yeah, the CIA made some experiments
Leonardo
on that
da Vinci.
In the late 50s.
Leonardo da Vinci, he came back as Nikola Tesla.